The new Porsche 911 facelift, in this form here, as it stands here right now, the 911 Carrera 4S convertible. That is today on Autogefühl, your number one resource for in-depth car reviews and your number one community to discuss cars. We're going to talk about the exterior, especially this very yellow color. We'll discuss it, the interior, and of course the changes that the facelift has brought to, and of course the turboization of the whole 911 model palette. And much more to come now on Autogefühl in full screen, full HD and full length. Let's start with the front design, and the headlights have been changed just a little bit, and the facelift brought the lower air intakes a little bit more in line. And it brought two new very spectacular colors. One is here, racing yellow, so called. And at first I thought, oh, what the hell, yellow Porsche, come on. But I can tell you, when you're driving it, it grows on you really, because it's so unique. But my favorite color would be the new Miami blue. This is a very bright blue, blue color. We can also see it in another preview video. That one would be my favorite color, definitely. Now to the side profile. We have the car opened at the moment, but we'll also soon show you how it looks like with the roof closed. Will be very exciting to see if it comes close to the coupe version then. 19-inch would be the standard rims in the 911 facelift. These ones here are 20-inch rims. They come with the S models, or you can always pick them optional. Spider design, I really like the design. What about you? Put me your opinion in the comments. And also the tire is a little bit protecting the rim. It's a good solution. It's a little bit higher overlapping. I also like the side mirrors, as you can go in, you know, in this hole through here. It looks very beautiful, in my opinion, very sporty. And then on to the rear, we see the 911 itself has very, very massive shoulders. And here, as it is an all-wheel drive model, the AWD models have 44 millimeters broader wheel arches here, or broader shoulders, and you can also see that from the rear. It looks huge, but it's not a huge car. 4.50 meters of length and right here. And the tail has been redesigned a little bit more, because we see those no tail lights there. Very sleek and also have a kind of 3D effect. I think it's very beautiful design. The all-wheel drive models then have this connecting strip in between, and this is a very spectacular one and makes design even more modern. And here you can also see that the AWD models also are 44 millimeters broader, really massive stance here on the road. The exhaust here in the S model, we'll get double exhaust, but no matter if you have double or single, everything is central now with the facelift. The 911 is very beautiful as a coupe and has even more of that effect, that it looks like a wrap is really strongly pulled over the car. But when a car is available as a convertible, I would always go for the open top version. We can also close the roof also here with the key. It's a very good solution. Takes about 13 seconds, that's the official figure. We can compare it if it's really true. And it's good, for example, if you get out of the car and already start walking somewhere to the ice cream parlor or whatever. And so that's it. And as you can see, it's kept very low from the roofline. And I think it comes very, very close to the design line of the coupe, or what do you think? You can also open it with this button here again, and it's really a handy solution because the opening process already starts when you're about to approach the car, and when you're finishing approaching the car, probably everything is already finished then. That's it. And if you continue holding, then also the windows slide up. But I would actually, when it's very hot, of course, leave the windows down. But I can also show you there are more features to get the wind out the car. Because in the middle console, this is here to control the roof, open, closed. In the middle one here, this is for the new automatic wind deflector. It slides up when I press the button. When I press it here now, you see how fast it goes. 3 seconds maybe. And you can change very quickly between maximum wind protection and being able to put some bags here, or maybe some, let's say, smaller people on the emergency seats. Right next to the beautiful entry cover, we got the two buttons for the hood in the front. This is the trunk actually, and here, well, we cannot see the engine directly, but at least we can see where the fuel fluids come to. See it right here. We cannot see the power of the engine, but we can see where we can put some new fluids in. And no, that's not a new massive rear wing, of course. Well, talking about the engines, that is where a lot of very true Porsche fans say, ah, what are they doing there? And well, what have they done? Less of displacement, now 3 liter. It's a 6-cylinder flat engine still. And you get 20 horsepower more, means 370 horsepower in the normal version and 420 horsepower in this S version here. So more horsepower, better in the acceleration, but less of displacement, and you get the turbo now. So, and that is always the question, well, you know, there was the 911 turbo before. So now everyone that is already driving a basis 911 can say, I drive a 911 turbo. That would maybe one advantage of that one. The disadvantage is that the consumption will not go down. It will rather go up. I can tell you that so far, 12 liters on 1 kilometer, you can consume with this engine if you're not driving on a normal turbo. And with the naturally aspirated one, you could even consume a little bit less before. But you will get more performance, and more about that, of course, in the driving experience. So what do you think about this change here? And we will, of course, listen to the sound, both without and with the extra exhaust button. So, the Boxster or the Cayman has the advantage as also a trunk in the rear here. You only have one in the front. It is okay to put a trolley here like this in, well, but you see also maybe some boxes for beverages, but not too much space. Of course, you have to be aware of that. Door handles, they flip out a little bit to the top, very interesting concept. Then a long door, of course, for a two-door car. You get sport seats plus as they are right now, and bucket seats, but just say with the standard seats, they weigh enough. The sport seats plus have a little bit more side support here. What the one disadvantage is, you can only get genuine leather. We have to wait maybe for the GTS model to get microfiber on the inside. But just ask your Porsche dealer when you order a car that you want microfiber also with the standard car, because there's also this individual in the price list, and maybe there is an option you can still get it even if it's not in the standard setup. Electric controls here on the lower part for almost everything. Lumbar support here, then back of the seats in the front, length of the seat right there, goes wide in there, the adjustment, and also how tight you want to have the lower part or tight you want to have the upper part of the seat. So a lot to do there, but that's not with every seat, of course. The new steering wheel in the 918 Spider design, you can get them with buttons on it or without. Here it's more the pure design without buttons. Just that one, that is for the driving modes, normal, sport, sport plus and individual. We'll talk about those when we drive the car. Then the standard 911 setup with the instruments, still a very beautiful design with all the round gauges here, definitely. And the infotainment system, you can see it's a new one, it's very flat, and there's a new software on there. We'll go in detail on that one very soon. And look how well everything is processed, and well, you could easily do that also with faux leather, but I mean, like the processing, how exact everything is aligned, and also with this classic analog clock, which has a cover in itself, so they really think about the details here in the interior. As for the comfort of the seats, yes, of course, it's a sports car and you sit relatively low, but for being a sports car, it still offers you quite of a good comfort. Also that the headrests are integrated is not really a disadvantage, only if you flip the seats. I can show you that very soon. And as you can adjust them in a lot of different ways, that's also perfectly fine. So you have a little more space, for example, also in the Boxster. It's a little bit longer car then. And so also taller persons are getting along with here quite well, also as you can lengthen the seat area. The storage space is of course limited here in the front. Slim one at the speakers, and for example, for smaller bottles, if you put them in a lying position, then you've got some more space right here. Then for beverage holders, you can flip out that one. We've seen that also recently in the Boxster. It's a funny system, really. And you can here put some bigger bottles there as well. There, this takes some time to flip it out and in. The glove box, reasonable space in here. And then if you move on to the middle console, this one is very slim. Not sure what to do with that one. And below the armrest, you can put your smartphone. There's also the USB connection we need for the Apple CarPlay or charging it. And also the basement garage beeper you can hide there. It's of course not a convertible for four people, but you have those two emergency seats. You have additional storage space when you want to go on a journey. Put some traveling bag on here. There's some more space here, but that's rather irrelevant. Main thing is really you can put the travel bags here and then you have enough luggage space. That would be probably the most use because, well, tiny people could fit in here, and if you go very far into the front as a driver, by the way, it doesn't work that when you put up the seats, it slides down automatically. And if you have a seat a little bit higher, then you're also touching the top of the car with the seat. So, and well, getting in the back there, I can show you, well, could I still drive in that position? Hardly, maybe not. And then still, even then, for me, it's kind of no chance to sit here at all. And only if the roof is opened to get an impression. I'm 1.86 meters. What do you think of those yellow seat belts, by the way? Cool, what? And then there's also another secret. You can also slide down this, and then you can protect your seats when you want to put a bag on here. You have an even surface to put the bag here. Now the focus on the new infotainment unit. I really like it because it's kind of seamless. This is the PDC, the park distance control. Well, it starts below 100,000 euros, this whole 911 car in Germany, for example. This one here, the version, 130,000 euros. Come on, there should be a rear view camera then included. But what is good, you got the GPS included from standard equipment, even with the standard 911, and that's great. Also the smartphone integration we will show you very soon. This is how the new map looks like. And other from the menu, you can always access the hotkeys, the home buttons. You got this kind of app view here now. Phone can be connected via Bluetooth. I usually do that, but also with Apple CarPlay, I show you quite soon. At car, you can see some different states and, well, someone obviously drove with this car 255 kilometers an hour. I did not. I would never do that. I drive fast with the car, but that's, come on, that's only thing, something for the racetrack, seriously. So, media, you can also get the music in here and some sound settings. So you got this app view, which is nice, and you see the reaction times, the responsive times of this system is really good, has been improved a lot. I like that. When I plug in smartphone here now, Apple or something else, or could have been Android car, automatically the CarPlay accept here. So, well, it's pretty simple. Here it says connection lost because I had it connected via Bluetooth. And now the Bluetooth is overridden by the cable connection, and this is really a nice screen you have here. With clicking on Porsche, you can get into the normal screen back again, but you can also access your telephone or your favorite music here. Some 90s stuff here as well. For me, E17, what do you think about that person, guys? So you can check your favorite music here, or just go home button again. This is the normal Porsche home button. Then you can access the CarPlay here, for example, again, and always press the home button, like on the iPhone, and you can access the telephone and messages as you would usually do, or use your own GPS. Phone function here, for example.
Mit wem möchtest du sprechen?
This is Siri starting, and then I could call a name, and then the name is being called. It works pretty well. The climate unit, they get great sounds, like click, click. They've worked on that one. AC and stuff, heated seats when you turn on the engine. Also cool seats are available. Well, you need them because of Geno leather. You sweat in summer times and you get cold in winter times. It's the classic unit we know so far. And well, I'm not sure if it will be replaced at some point. Maybe goes up into the infotainment screen. Now it is as it right now. What is strange is that we always got the setting with AC on and 22 degrees when we restart the car. I have searched for in the menu to change that, but I haven't found anything. Maybe one of you guys knows. More buttons here. We have covered the central ones. Here, PDCC. That is for the adaptive control for the suspension. You can put it harder then. ESC off. If you want to have some fun on the racetrack, check our 718 Boxster review, because we could use that one on an airfield and then re-spin around the car. And on the right side, this exhaust valve button. You can re-let the great sound. And start stop function off, and here for the rear wing you can flip that one out. You can do it manually, see it right here, but of course usually you just leave that because it goes in and out automatically depending on your speed. Instruments, we start at the left with the oil information for temperature and filling status, then the speedometer, 330, seriously? Oh, I don't think so. Big RPM meter then here with a digital speed in the lower part. And then here, the digital one, we can adjust that. And the very right one for the fuel status. And well, the digital one is of course the most interesting one. Here we see the AWD status, how much torque is at the rear and at the front wheels. Predominantly you get the rear wheel drive and a little bit in the front, and just when there's a lot of wheel spin, then more is directed to the front. Or also, for example, when you have the launch control with the PDK. You can put other information here, like the chronometer, start-stop clock, for example, here. And then also the analog clock is running, and you can see it here as well. And time your laps. Then you can go back here. And for example, go to a shifting assistant, G meter, see when you're in the corners, then it goes right and left. How much speed is allowed, information, Bluetooth, telephone information, and also the GPS info. Let's start our convertible ride. You maybe heard it, there was the stop-start function active, so in the normal driving mode the engine also just shuts. And what I'm going to explain to you is the spread between the comfort ride and the dynamic ride. We'll start very comfortably, and moreover, we get sportier, go to the motorway, to the famous German Autobahn, and also have at the very end a great dynamic ride up the hill, and we'll also have a tunnel sound check. So stay tuned here with our driving part. We will have a lot of fun together. As we start here with open top, it got a little bit warmer now here as well, so I can also tell you something about the wind features. And the good thing here with the new 911 facelift is that the spread between the comfy and the sporty ride has been widened up. That means when I'm here in the normal driving mode, in normal suspension settings, this is the most comfortable 911 ever. And I do feel a difference to the latest 911 ride I had before the facelift, definitely. And that's very pleasing to me, because most of the time, of course, a 911 will not be used on a racetrack, will be used in normal driving on countryside roads and in the city. And there you really just profit from this comfort. With the new turbo engine, the car is also more silent in the normal driving mode. You almost don't hear the engine at all. So be aware of that if that's very important to you. I think we are, you know, at the paradigm change here now, because I think it gets less and less important that you have a totally loud sound. It's nice to have a very refined sound, yes, but that, you know, totally loud sound where, you know, wake up everyone around you is maybe not up to date that much anymore. Or what's your opinion to that one? Put me your opinion in the comments. However, you do have a choice here. I will soon show you that. Here, really, let me just accelerate. So, second gear now. Yeah, that's just a little bit when you leave the throttle again. But in general, you also hear this little bit from the turbo, I suppose. Have you heard that? First car starts, and then it's... And I think that's the sound of the turbo. So from the sound, it is a step back, definitely, from the naturally aspirated engine we had before. But you have more performance, especially here in the S version, 3-liter, 6-cylinder, 420 horsepower. So even if you're going very slow, and maybe in fourth, or even there are 7 gears here in the manual shift, I can be in the 5th gear and then go through the throttle, and still something is happening. It's really amazing. And I do realize it, especially here with the manual shift, that you don't have to shift that often, because the turbo gives power at any point. Before, with naturally aspirated engine, sometimes it happened that, you know, have to shift down first to get very good performance. Here it doesn't matter so much, because the turbo always gives you power. So just performance-wise speaking, it is good. 4 seconds, by the way, from 0 to 100 kilometers or 0 to 60 miles an hour, you see acceleration figure. With the convertible, it's, I think it's like one hundredth more, so 0.1 second more. And then again with the S version, you're a little bit faster again. Also, all-wheel drive model is a little bit faster again. Everything is in about 4 second region from 0 to 1 kilometers. Here again, stop start function that is activated in the normal mode. So you can drive this car very silently inside the city and very comfortably, you know. And that is also one sense of the facelift, which is, I think, quite good. That is actually possible. I also always take a look at the all-wheel drive status here, because, well, you can get a 911, of course, just with rear-wheel drive. But with so much power, it does make sense for most of the drivers to go for the all-wheel drive model. They have been increasing sales a lot recently, because you have more security. Because if you're not a very practiced sport driver and hammer the throttle at some point, then with the all-wheel drive, more power is transported to the front wheels. It's not that easy that the rear is slipping out. Here with the normal drive, more power is transported to the rear wheels. For example, now almost 100% if I'm just rolling. Only if I push the throttle harder, then I see it's like a, let's say, three quarters to the rear and one quarter to the front, for example. Would be more on the front when I really got some rear wheel spin, or if I would use the launch control in the PDK. I don't have the dual clutch transmission here today. They're both 7-speed. Here, 7-speed manual shift is really a great sports shifting experience. Doesn't take long to shift, and you always, you know, feel strong when shifting. So that's what a sporty driver would expect. Now we're closely getting to our motor guard, and there we can also set in the sport mode. I'm gonna change it here with a new changer knob on the steering wheel. The sport mode automatically activates the exhaust valve. I could also activate it solely with the button, that would be possible, but the sport mode automatically activates it. And then when I leave the throttle, you already hear the sound rumbling. And if I go to sport plus, then also the suspension is stiffened up. I could also do that with the button separately, but that suspension is really something for the race week because it just gets uncomfortable on the road. You get like this. So it's great really to have even more connection to the road, but usually just leave it in a normal driving mode. And there already you have got so much support from suspension. Look at that one. It's go-kart driving. Direct translation from steering wheel commands to the road. It's so much fun to drive this car. Only the Boxster or the Cayman is even more agile because of the central engine, the midship concept, and has even a little bit more agility, but this one already really at the top of sporty agility. But then back again to our sport mode. They are already the electronic stability control is drawn just a little bit, and it's enough. I won't go sport plus mode on official roads. Again, if you want to see me spinning around the Porsche, check the 718 Boxster review. There we had an open airfield closed circuit to do all of the fun stuff, and there I could also activate all the stuff, and there you can see also tires screaming and stuff. But we'll get a sporty part with this car here, of course, as well. What I always love when driving this car is, especially in this color, you see the color of the mirrors here also from the inside, and also to the front of the hood, you see the shapes of the headlights. It's great stuff. And now acceleration, for example, in third gear to 100 with the sound activated. Let's go. That's 100. Yeah, it was even a little bit more. And there's nothing behind me. That's always a funny thing, of course. And you heard the difference. Also, when we did the sound test on the outside, there was a huge difference from the normal mode to the exhaust valve mode. Really a huge difference. So with the new exhaust valve mode here, there the sound is really great, and you can still have that ultrasound if you want to have it, but at the same time just clicking a knob and have a very silent car again. You see, I've raised up all windows and I have the wind deflector in place, and 100 kilometers an hour is a speed where you can drive with open top also on the motorway. Not too much wind turbulences and also not getting too cold. Above 100 kilometers, it tends to get a little bit uncomfortable. That's with most convertibles. As for the wind features, this 911 convertible sits in between a lot of cars we tested. So worse is, for example, the small roadsters, Audi TT, the 718 Boxster, or also a Jaguar F-Type. Those are worse as for the wind features. Better again, it means more silent, are all the mid-size convertible that are based on mid-size cars like Audi A5 or maybe even combat Audi A3 convertible, or for example BMW 4 Series. Those ones really shut up the wind and you can go with them all time, all season. So this one here is placed between the just summer convertibles and the all-season convertibles. So I would say it comes close to the all-season convertibles. I would drive it all season, also open, but the other ones deliver you a little bit more comfort still. But so just you know how to react on that one. We also have a cruise control in here, and that is all hidden behind the steering wheel with different levers, turning indicators for the wipers, cruise control, and the control for the central screen. And still I always take a look at the AWD status control, and again, more power is at the rear wheels at the moment. Soon we'll also close the roof, then we can check how the acoustic setup works there, because at the moment it's quite loud in here, of course, as we're driving with the open top. And when we have closed the roof, we also go at high speed. We also have a small part of the Autobahn where we have unlimited speed. There we can really hammer the throttle and also hear something more of the sound. But of course, when the top is opened, you can hear really a lot of the sound here always. Nice. By the way, if you're in the sport mode and shift down, there's automatically a throttle blip applied. When I, for example, go now from fourth gear to third gear, listen to it. I didn't do that myself. That was done by the car, and well, it's a nice sporty feature here, of course, to have this throttle blip. In German, we say Zwischengas, by the way. So, and we're getting off the motorway here, and then now, if I just leave the throttle, listen to the sound, it's just amazing. I'm not sure if you're hearing that. Blop, 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 blop. Nice. Now again, listen when I shift down. Throttle blip. Another one. Very nice. So, and now we'll have a short break, then I'll close the roof. It worked until 50 kilometers an hour, but we have to switch the camera mounting a little bit. Don't want that the cameras can be sucked in by the windows here. And then we'll go to the motorway again. Close the roof, test the sound insulation, and even more power to the performance here. And we're back again. I've closed the roof. Works quite fast, by the way. As I said, I had to demount the camera for that one. And now we can really show you some more performance. Go into sport mode. Let's go. Wow. 130. And now 120 to... 170 in the third gear, and 200. Wow, totally amazing, and really loud in the sportless mode. Oh my god, wow. So that worked pretty fast, right? And now again, short of it. Nice. Just enjoy. We move that part back again, once more. Then I can show you the performance even more, and well, even at high speeds, of course, you have such a stability. For example, now at 100 kilometers now, wow, the car is so stiff, even in a normal suspension setup. I wouldn't even think about going stiffer even with the suspension. Doesn't really make sense for me. Wow, and your adrenaline gets pumped up, of course. Whew. Nice, right. Shall we repeat that, guys? One more we have here. And of course, our agility part, where we go into some sharper corners. We're back to our convertible ride with cruising a little bit, and the tunnel part is approaching, and also our short agility ride. Right now I've switched back to the normal driving mode to relax a little bit, calm down again. And because for the tunnel I'll go to into sport mode, and as we have now the open top, it's the best way to enjoy that sound, of course. See here, you hardly hear anything in the normal mode. You can also at the beginning of the tunnel go leave it in the normal mode. and you hear it. Hear this from the turbo. Not so much. Now the sport mode. What do you think? And wow. So wasn't me. Those were some motorbikes now. But I think this very difference here we heard is also one of the essence of this review, because it shows the spread between calm and comfort and loud and sporty. As I said, this is one of the key factors of this car, especially after the facelift. Now, stay in sport mode and we'll have some agility fun to close up our today's review. Of course, there will still be the conclusion, but now I'd say enjoy these corners with me. Someone who wants to enjoy these corners as well, but maybe not at the same speed. Will he let us by, or shall we wait a little bit to have it a little bit more entertaining for you? We're calm drivers. We'll just wait a little bit. I go back to the normal mode. Be silent again. Cruise, let the sunshine in. Enjoy nature. Don't destroy any people. Don't annoy any people living here. Also, when cross traffic is coming by, totally silent. Now, again, sport mode. Let's go. See this handling here. Great. There we caught our friend again. So, and maybe what about sliding out the rear? Well, if you're in the sport mode, if you really hammer the throttle, then it's happening, but of course not that early with the all-wheel drive models. If you're in the Sport Plus mode, you really have to pay attention that you don't slide the rear out. And then you can draw back the electronic stability control to have a full playing around, but that's nothing you usually would use. Again, more information on the different driving modes, how they react on the car, is also in our Boxster review, which we could do there on closed circuit. So, I had a lot of fun driving this car. Especially because I am a big convertible fan. Such a refined sports car, definitely. And I hope you enjoyed it as well. Let's now come to our final verdict. Porsche 911 facelift, the 911 as we say in Germany, here as the 4S convertible. This is now our verdict. Well, there has been a lot of discussion about the new 911 facelift because the turbo was put in there and, well, it doesn't give any advantages on the consumption. It's more negative for this side. Also, the sound without the extra exhaust button is not that good, and you also hear the turbo. when you have that extra option with the exhaust button, the extra valve, then you have still a great sound, and maybe that one's even more refined than before. And then, of course, the exterior has been refined. I think it's very beautifully done. I really like the changes to the taillights, for example, and especially in this all-wheel drive model with this additional horizontal line we have connecting the taillights. Very beautifully done. The interior, as refined as ever, with a new infotainment screen that is reacting pretty fast. I really like that. Also, you can even put the Apple CarPlay and stuff in there. The only thing that was missing is that we have an option without genuine leather, but as I said, just ask your Porsche dealer, make some pressure as a customer and say, hey, I also want, like for example, in the basis Boxster, want some microfiber in there. And then the driving, well, there, the turbo is really promising because it has just the performance you might want to have. And even if you're now in a manual gear shift as we have driven, being in fourth gear with those speeds, no problem. You don't even have to shift because the power is always there. So the performance is very impressive. And the car is now more comfortable and sporty at the same time. So overall, it's the most comfortable 911 drive ever. So from the driving experience, I must really say this facelift model has stepped this game even more up, and well, it was hardly possible. So the best 911 ride I had so far. So overall, despite the discussions on the turbo, still a really a dream car, no discussion about that. And overall, everything is so right, so refined, you have such an agility ride. Only maybe internally you can match that with the Boxster or the Cayman because you have that central engine. So yeah, I want to hear your feedback to this car, to the color, of course, to the exterior, interior, and what we've told you with the driving. And join us for more Porsche reviews, of course, and all the other brands we cover here on Autogefühl. Thank you very much for watching our episode here with Thomas, and we'll see each other at the next episode.